This show is made possible through the kind support and contributions from its listeners. If you enjoy the show, please head on over to the Support the Show link on the webpage. You can provide a donation, buy some merchandise, get a BrainsMatter smartphone app, or just spread the word about the show. Of course, if you know of any organisations willing to sponsor the show, please contact me at the website. Now on to the episode. Welcome to Brains Matter, a podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to today's episode of Brains Matter. On today's show, I speak to Marita Cheng, the founder of Robogals. Who are the Robogals? Well, listen in and find out. So Marita, can you tell us a little bit about yourself, your background?
Okay, well, I was born in a small regional city called Cairns in Far North Queensland, and I studied there all throughout my life until high school. And then even when I was in year 12, I didn't really know what I wanted to do, but I really enjoyed my maths and my physics. And
yeah, of course you would.
And then in year 12, there was an opportunity that I saw in the school newsletter to go down to Brisbane to attend the Engineering Link project, which is like a camp that goes for about 4 days for year 10 to 12 students who are interested in maths and science. And so I said to Mum, oh, you know, this looks really great. Can I go? And my mum's really supportive of me doing anything academic. So she said, okay, yeah, sure. So a couple of weeks later, I was on my way down to Brisbane and I attended the Engineering Link project. And that was really fun because I got to meet like-minded students from all over Queensland.
Did you find that different to being in school where you might have been the more, I wouldn't say nerdy, but academically focused person compared to other people in school?
Yeah, it was definitely a different dynamic to have lots of people around you that, you know, could talk about geeky things and just enjoy it. And yeah, there were a few girls there as well, which is nice. Not many, but a few. And it was really fun because we learnt about a different stream of engineering every day and we got to choose out of like 7 or so, pick your top 4 kind of thing. And I just really liked how it was really flexible. So you can take an engineering degree and go into business, or you can go into like management later on, or even if you did a mechanical engineering degree, you could, if you decided that you wanted to do mining engineering, you could go back to uni for a year and get your mining engineering degree as well. So it was just really flexible like that. So mm-hmm. I was like, oh yeah, this sounds really good. But my mum wanted me to do medicine because she says it's really
stable,
it pays well, you know what's going to happen. You get your medicine degree after 6-7 years, then you go in, do your residency, and then you go back and study and you specialize, and then you're rich and you're set for life. But like, to me that just sounded, you know, a little bit boring, but I went along. And in December, after my results came out, I went down to Monash University for my medicine interview. Mm-hmm. And they asked me all these questions about biology that I couldn't answer because I hadn't done biology since year 8. And then they finished off by asking me to respond to a scenario about a boy called Tom and how Tom wanted to study history, but his parents wanted him to be a lawyer. And so in the end, Tom enrolled into history, but he didn't tell his parents. So what I had to do was I had to say, what should I do? What would I do if I was Tom? And so by this stage, I kind of thought, oh, Tom's like me, and I really don't want to be here. And so I said, Tom should just do history. And then the interview was over after that. And as soon as I was outside the building, I called my mum and I called my dad and I said to them, I'm doing engineering, that's it. And
yeah. As long as you didn't say, I'm Tom.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I'm not interested in law, so, so yeah. And so, yeah, down I came to Melbourne. And
so why did you come down to Melbourne in particular? Was it specifically for that Monash interview, or were you planning on moving to Melbourne anyway?
Well, I really like the residential colleges here. I thought they had really good cultures at them, and if I went to any other university around Australia, I didn't know where I'd live. So I thought, okay, well, I have a place to live in Melbourne, so I'll go there. But yes, all about the elements just meshing up and just being right. So after a year and a half of studying here in Melbourne, I was at an awards ceremony, and I spoke to the head of the head of electrical engineering department, Jamie Evans, because I wanted him to fund a robot team that I had started up at the
So,
university.
is this like those Japanese TV shows where you see those robots fighting against each other? Is it that kind of thing?
No, not quite, not quite. Although lots of people have mentioned those robo wars, so I don't know. I think that would be quite popular if we did something around that,
That's the next
but
goal.
I digress. So I was talking to Jamie, and I was trying to get him to fund a robot team that I'd started up at the university, and he told me about how he had an idea to get more girls interested in engineering, and it was if we had university students go out to girls' schools and teach girls from around grades 5 to 7 robotics. And so basically, it was in that conversation that Robogals was formed, and I went away and I thought about it, and I thought, well, if we can do this to if we can teach one school, why don't we teach all the schools? And so I rallied up about 30 of my friends, which is pretty easy to do when you live in a residential college with 90 other people. And out of those 30, I got 3 girls to work with me during the holidays and creating some lessons and creating a competition for the girls that we taught to participate in at the end of the year. And we started calling schools, and within about 3 weeks we had 60 to 80 student volunteers who'd signed up, and then within the first like 3 months we taught 120 full girls. And so yeah, that was really exciting. And at around that time as well, I went to Imperial College London to study on a year of exchange in mechanical engineering, and naturally I wanted to start up Robogals there as well, and so I did. And yeah, while I was over there, I realized that a lot of the clubs over there weren't just in one place, but because England's so small, they're national. And I thought, well, that'd be really great if Robogals was national in Australia, because then we could make even more of an impact and not just in Melbourne. And so yeah, I came back to Melbourne and I ran a training boot camp and invited 4 of the top universities around Australia to come. So yeah, 6 girls from each of those universities came, learnt about Robogals, learnt about how to start their own chapters, and then went back and did it. And yeah, using that same method, we've now got 17 chapters in 6 countries around the world, and
Okay.
we've
How
taught.
did you start the other countries apart from England?
Oh, well, New Zealand. So we invited New Zealand to Australia, and then yeah, 6 months after the Australian boot camp, I went back to London and did a boot camp there, and we invited Ireland and the Netherlands as well earlier this year. And I invited one girl from Edinburgh who was going on exchange to Caltech, and who said, oh, I'm kind of interested in starting up something like this in Caltech. And so I said, okay, come on over, come to our boot camp. And so she yeah, came to our boot camp, and then she's already done her year of exchange at Caltech. And I let her have her fun while she was in Caltech, but she did manage to find someone in Caltech to start doing stuff. So yeah, that's how we started up there. And the other US university that we have is the University of Arizona, and that was just through someone I met at the University of Wollongong, who said that her friend was interested in this, and
So it's
then
all through the networks that you establish.
yeah, it's all just through random conversations that you have, or just saying yes to different opportunities and seeing what comes out of it.
So what's the primary aim of what Robogals is out to do? So you mentioned education to younger females. Is it primarily aimed at females? The name implies that. So is it primarily aimed at females? And what is it that you want to do at the end of the day to say we've been successful?
Yep, so our aim is to get more girls interested in science, engineering, and technology. And so we wanna just promote science, engineering, and technology so that girls actually know what engineering is, and girls actually know what they can do with a background in these subjects. And that's our aim. At the end of the day, we want the girls to have all these options and then choose what's best for them. But if they don't, you know, if they don't even have the option of science or maths on the table, then they can't go down this path. So we target primarily 10 to 14 year olds because they haven't yet chosen their high school subjects. Like they haven't chosen whether they'll do specialist, like the hardest type of maths or physics or chemistry. And rather than saying do engineering at the age of 11 or something, we're saying keep your mind open. Maybe, you know, just choose maths and in 5 years, maybe you'll want to do something with engineering. Maybe you'll want to do something with computers or robotics or whatever. But just keep that door open. Don't shut it off when you're 11.
Well, so I guess if you're exposing them to maths and engineering and science concepts at that age, and they're interested in, and do pursue something else, they can always come back to it later as well.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I mean, as long as you have that background, then there's just so many options open.
Mm-hmm.
And currently the statistics are like only 22% of high schoolers, of year 12 students study
the physical sciences? Or
like, yeah, or other like special maths methods. And
so yeah, for those outside Australia, that's calculus and that sort of thing.
Yeah, so there's only basically the number of students that are studying the hard maths are declining, and we want to do something about that, because if those numbers decline, then the number of students entering into engineering also declines, and mm-hmm. the number of engineers going into the field also declines. And currently there's only 10% of females, female engineers in the field, and only 14% of girls do engineering. So, and the 14% has been consistent. It has been the same for the past 20 years or so. So nothing's really shifted, and we wanna help shift that.
So that's one of the primary motivations, is to get that equality.
Yeah, definitely. And Australia has a lack of engineers in general. So in the 5 years leading up to 2011, 70,000 engineers retired, and there's only 45,000 graduate engineers to take their places. So,
mm-hmm.
so if we had an equal number of girls and boys doing engineering, then we wouldn't have that disparity.
So when you were doing your undergrad in engineering, did you find that big contrast in the gender balance?
Yeah, I'm still doing my undergrad in engineering, but definitely, okay. Yeah, like I was really surprised when I rocked up on the first day of uni and there were like 5 girls in my course, and I was like, what? What's with that? But in mechanical engineering, there are about like 10, 15 girls out of 150 or so. In Imperial College, there were 4 girls out of 120 doing computer science, and like 2 girls doing aerospace out of 150. It was just insane. Like, there's just no girls.
Do you find that there's a correlation between the type of engineering and the proportion? So are there more girls in, say, environmental engineering or something like that?
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot more girls in, like, environmental, chemical, or biochemical. And so one of the reasons for that is that girls like to know that they're making a difference with what they do. They want to know why they do it, whereas boys are just okay with just doing it. So that's one of the things that we want to incorporate into our lessons as well, that engineers don't just build buildings and build bridges and work on all this technology. They do it for a reason, to make our lives better, or to help, you know, make things quicker and expand the collective human knowledge. So yeah, I think that's one of the reasons why there's that disparity.
So in terms of what you do when you actually go out to a school, what is it you talk about? So how do you actually approach the school, and how do you engage with that school, and then what do you do when you go there?
So we usually engage with the school through either cold calling or through being introduced by a contact. And then we tell the school the programs that we have on offer. So we'll either say that we want to go and do a robotics workshop at their school, or we'll invite them to come to the university to do a robotics workshop at the university. And that just depends on the resources that they have. So if they have their own robotics kits, then we can go to their school. But if they don't, then they'll have to come to the university. As well as that, if we hold any community events, so if we have a science fair or a science expo or a really fun activity like that coming up, then we'll invite them to that. And so, yeah, after we've sorted out the logistics, and we'll hold a robotics lesson. And the robotics lesson typically consists of one of our volunteers speaking about engineering and what it entails, and just making it sound really fun and exciting, which is easy to do because it is. And then we'll do a short activity with them, which gets them thinking about the different kinds of engineering, so it's not just one thing, and what different kinds of engineering have an impact in the areas. And then we'll do, if there's enough time, they'll build their robots using the Lego NXT or RCX systems, and then they'll do programming exercises on their computer and make their robots do different things.
And let's take a break for a moment and find out who today's listener of the episode is. Today's listener of the episode is Brad Milne, who's somewhere out in Japan at the moment, I believe. Hope you're enjoying the show, Brad. Now back to Marita.
So these are pre-existing kind of robotic kits that you can use, or they could use if you weren't there even.
Yeah, definitely. So Lego has come out with like a robotics kit, and it's Lego, so it's really customizable depending on your interests. And you know, you make a mistake, you pull it apart. It's just really easy to do, really easy to build. So it's a great system, and that's what we use to bring out to schools. As well as that, it's because people have grown up with Lego. They're already very accustomed to how it works. But yeah, we'll be adding like civil engineering aspects to our lessons as well in the future, just so the girls are exposed to not just robotics and programming, but also a bit of civil engineering as well.
Some of the concepts. I remember back in school having to build a popsicle bridge.
Yeah. Yeah, so building bridges and then having the robots like go across the bridges, that kind of thing. So yeah, that's what we'll do, and then we'll have lots of activities that require them to work in teams and program their robots to do different formations and yeah, just fun activities like that.
So what's some of the feedback you've got from the students, or something you've seen personally when you've done that?
Yeah, we've got really good feedback from the students. They really enjoy it. They think that some of the comments are like, this is the best science double ever. We did a survey. We've just started doing surveys this year. And one of our surveys, we've done 348 surveys so far. And they said that before the class, they were about 4.2 out of 10 interested in engineering before our workshop. And then they were like 8 out of 10 interested in engineering after our class. So it's really good to know that we're making that difference.
That's a huge difference.
Yeah, and I think one of the main things is just bringing a lot of energy and enthusiasm to it. Because if you bring a lot of enthusiasm and energy, then they feed off that and get really excited about it as well. And
perhaps there's a bit of perception in there as well, because engineering is seen as a male domain, quote, quote. And so the females might think, oh, my dad does that, but I don't want to do that. I want to go and do whatever it is,
yeah,
and then actually do it and realize it's fun.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that, yeah, that's the other reason we target 10 to 14 year olds, is because that's before a lot of the stereotypes have set in, and it's also when girls are still like energetic enough to get involved and do something like this. But we also find it's really important that we teach girls and boys separately so that they don't compete with each other, because we found that boys tend to just jump in and do it and get it wrong and then keep doing it and doing it. And
so
then
what happens in a scenario like that if you go to a co-ed school? Do the boys complain that they're not getting involved, or what happens there?
We separate the girls and the boys if we have to teach them both, and we teach them both different lessons so that they're not competing against each other, because girls tend to be a bit more cautious in their approach, and they'll kind of analyze it a bit more so that when they do build it or when they do program it, they get it right. And that kind of slows them down just like a little bit. And then by slowing down a little bit throughout the class, and they get disinterested because they're like, oh, I'm not doing this very well. So if we give them different lessons and the girls go along at their pace and the boys go along at their pace, then they don't feel like they're competing, and they both can feel a sense of accomplishment.
You actually do provide lessons to both girls and boys.
We do lessons for girls and boys, but we focus more on girls. So for all our statistics that we quote to the media, we we only quote the girls that we've taught. So yeah, we've taught 3,000 girls since we started.
And how long has it been since you started?
Since July 2008.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, we have taught a few boys, but we don't quote those statistics because it's not relevant, I guess.
Well, irrelevant, but I guess that's not what you're aiming to change.
Yeah.
So in terms of your the RoboGirl staff, are they all volunteers or are they paid, or how does the organisation work?
Yeah, everyone's a volunteer. So we have a global team that looks after all the chapters all over the world. And then at each of our chapters, we have an executive committee, which has 6 people in it, and they make everything happen. As well as that, we have a conference in each of our regions once a year to brush up on skills training, networking, and just instill a sense of community.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we have a conference coming up in 2 weeks' time, which is really exciting.
I see you've got a particularly geeky t-shirt on there. Did you want to describe it to the listeners?
Yeah, so we come up with a different t-shirt every year so that our volunteers can wear a Robogals t-shirt and feel part of the team when they go out to school. So this one I'm currently wearing has HTML code on the front, which says that I'm a robot and that you should visit our website at robogals.org. And then on the back there's a big Robogals logo on it.
So me being the geek that I am, looked at that and I immediately understood what it means.
That's good.
Do you have to explain it to people when they see it?
No, I think they just think that it's really geeky and then they leave it at that.
Well, so what do you hope for the organisation in the next couple of years, say?
Well, we're working on getting a structure that's sustainable. So I graduate from uni at the end of next year, and at that stage I hope to hand on the organisation to the next leadership. And so we're just looking at different structures whereby that can happen, and so that's really exciting. We're also expanding to America next year in February, so we're holding a conference at Caltech and inviting universities all over America to that. We're also updating our lessons and just improving everything, which we always do. In terms of our longer term goals, we want to be an international organization. We want our impact to be felt all over the world, and as part of that, we've started up a few new programs this year. One of the programs is called the Robogals Drill and Regional Program, where we bring our robotics workshops and our aim not just to the big cities, the big capital cities where we are now, but we bring them out to the smaller regional cities or the towns in each of the states around Australia. So we've been doing 2 things as part of the Robogals Drill and Regional Program. One of the things is we've been getting our chapters to, for example, go to Geelong for a week and just teach as many schools and girls as possible in that week. And the volunteers love it because they see it as a bit of a holiday, chance to get away and make some new friends. So yeah, that's been really successful. And I've taught lots of girls through that, and we've gotten great feedback because the schools out there just love the opportunity to have something like this. Another part of the program was to get female engineering students from rural and regional universities to come to a training weekend and learn presentation and leadership skills, and then go back to their home cities or hometowns really and speak at all the primary schools about engineering and the possibilities and opportunities there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also been really successful because, again, the schools just really like the opportunity to get more involved in the community and have this opportunity. So yeah, that we started the Robogals Drill and Regional Program in March this year, and so far we've already reached out to about 1,300 students. So yeah, it's been really great. And then the other thing that we started up just recently in July is the Robogals Science Challenge, which is a national competition throughout Australia, and we're encouraging girls to come up with a science experiment with help from their parent or a mentor, and then film a 4-minute video of them doing the science experiment or explaining it, and then uploading it online to YouTube and then putting it on our website. And that's been really, there's really good prizes with that because the winning child and their mentor get to come down to Melbourne and get flights paid for and stay at the Park Hyatt Hotel and get like a science themed weekend and get to come to our award ceremony. So yeah, it's really exciting, and we're promoting that now. And both those projects are currently only in Australia, but we're trialing them in Australia and tweaking them in Australia, and then if we think that they're going well, then we'll bring them to the other regions that we're in as well.
So if someone wants to start their own chapter, how should they approach you?
Oh, by sending me an email at marita@robogals.org. It's the best way.
So as long as they can get to you from your website, you're happy to take in suggestions and volunteers and so on?
Yeah, I'm always open to new ideas as to how we can connect more people in the community and come up with new ideas as to how different segments of people can get involved. For example, with all our robotics workshops that we do, it was only girls that lived in the city that were really benefiting from that. And in order to expand our reach, I thought, okay, rural and regional areas, let's go there. Mm-hmm. And so now rural and regional areas have been able to experience what we do. And then the science challenge is just another extension of that, where we're saying, well, we want girls from all over the country in primary school and high school to get involved, hence the 5 to 18 year old range. But there's different categories, of course. Mm. So the 5-year-old isn't competing against an 18-year-old. But yeah, it's just about expanding who we're talking to. And yeah, currently with our Robogals chapters, we've got all these female engineering students at the universities that we're at getting involved. But I'm always open to suggestions as to how girls who don't go to our universities that we're already at can get involved, and haven't found the solution yet. But I'm sure that we'll get there. Mm-hmm.
Well, Marita Cheng, I'd like to thank you for your time today. And to quote Kev Carmody, from little things, big things grow.
Great. Well, it was awesome to be here, and it was great meeting you.
And that's it for today's show. If you want to get in touch with the organisation, head on over to www.robogals.org. And I'll leave you with a quote from Helen Keller. Science may have found a cure for most evils, but it has found no remedy for the worst of them all, the apathy of human beings. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now. We'll be right back.